So good morning friends, and welcome to this next session of Dermatology Crash Course. Now we will be doing these sessions for the remaining of this month. Every day we'll take two sessions of Dermatology Crash Course, and we'll try to finish the whole Dermatology in this month up till the end, so that we can have a quick revision of whatever we have read. And we will prepare ourselves to the upcoming NEET PG entrance examination. Now, I'm Dr. Cheshta Agarwal, your NEET PG educator on An Academy, and I've myself scored All India rank 261 in my entrance examination. You all are on the best online platform for the preparation of NEET PG, that is An Academy. Download the An Academy learning app from the App Store. You can use your category or choose your category, that is NEET PG. Once you choose your category, you will get two stuff. One is free, which is the special classes. And another is paid. One is free, one is paid. And the paid is the two type of subscription. One is plus, another is iconic. Plus, give you an access to An Academy, daily live class, structured course, live test, and unlimited access to the platform. While Iconic, give you an access to An Academy and prep ladder with additional benefit of video lectures and rapid revision courses. We have a lot of integrated batch course, keeping in mind the new pattern of NEET PG entrance examination. So I request all of you to please be part of this integrated batch course. Focus FMG batch for December, FMG, last mile NEET PG, that is very important now for the quick revision of dermatology or any other subject. We have a target next 2022, professional year 3 batch course. So both these are the batches which will start from 21st, and this is for the next year or next to next year exams. Now, remember that we have recently launched a 2-month subscription of An Academy. That is a very limited time period offer where you can go for a 2-month subscription. Please use my code DrCheshtaYT, or you can use the code Cheshta10, whatever suits you. So please go with a 2-month subscription if you are planning for the NEET PG entrance examination. We have a very limited time period offer for Iconic, where we have revised prices. 4-year subscriptions are also available for both Plus and Iconic. And again, you can use the same code to get additional 10% discount on the above fees. Additional 10%. Like if you are prescribing this, you will get a direct discount of 75,000 rupees if you use this code. So that will be like a very beneficial thing for you. And if you see, this 4-year courses will be very cheap when you compare it per month. It will be around 1,000 rupees per month. So something like which you spend by eating a single pizza and all. So it's a very cheap thing. So I request all of you to please subscribe to An Academy, use my code DrCheshtaYT, and you can use my code Cheshta10. Longer the subscription, lesser will be the per month cost. Longer the subscription, lesser will be the per month cost. So please try to take it for a longer duration if you are not sitting for this exam. If you are planning for NEET PG, I will request you to go for a 2-month subscription. I will request you to go for a 2-month subscription of 65,000 rupees, which is, sorry, not 65,000, 6,500 rupees, which is way too cheap. Now, today's session will be a MCQ-based crash course of dermatology. If you find any inappropriate content in the video, you can go for a bug bounty program. Claim your prize when you report that complaint. So I want all of you to start with the first question of the today's session. Anyone can answer this question. Very nice. Now please remember that the skin is made up of three structures. I just want all of you to please look at this part. Skin is made up of the superficial part, which is called as epidermis. Then you have dermis, and then at the lower part you have subcutaneous tissue. Now please remember that dermoepidermal junction is present in a convoluted manner, and you have a characteristic basement membrane which is present at this part. Inside the epidermis, the cells are very compactly arranged, or they are adhered to each other, and this adhesion is made up of desmosomes. At the basement membrane, or just above that, the epidermal cells are connected with the help of hemidesmosome. And below the basement membrane, you have dermis, which is a rich source of collagen. So if you get back to this, the desmoglein was the intercellular connection in the epidermis. Hemidesmosome was the adhesion molecule between the epidermis and the basement membrane. Then laminin was the component of the basement membrane, and collagen 7 was the component of the dermis. So the sequence becomes number A, B, D and C. 1, 2, 4 and 3. The correct answer becomes option number 3. So please remember that the structure from top to bottom, this type of questions will be very, very commonly seen, specifically in your INICT entrance examination. Fine. So please remember that the structure from top to bottom becomes desmoglein, hemidesmosome, laminin, which is the part of basement membrane, and comes the last part, that is collagen 7. Now here are some of the layers. I will be discussing that little later. I want all of you to please look at this question, the next question. Anybody can answer this question. Desmosomes are damaged in pemphigus, and pemphigus has autoimmunity against desmosome. Now, I just want everyone to please see this image. Now, this is the different layers of the skin starting from top to bottom. Now, in these layers are the cellular layers, and these cells are connected to each other with a component, and that is called as desmosomes. So you have attachment of desmosomes here. They are present on the margins of the cells. Now what happens in the patients of pemphigus? You have autoimmunity, and IgG develops against one of the component of desmosome. What is the desmosome? Desmoglein. So we tend to see development of autoantibody against desmoglein component of desmosome, and because of this there is breakage of these connections. When there is breakage of this connection, the cell starts to separate. And there is accumulation of the fluid. Suprabasal cleft. Very classical. And what are these? These are acantholytic cells. Suprabasal cleft and acantholytic cells are something which is very, very important here. Okay? What are acantholytic cells? These are nothing but keratinocytes which have loosed or lost all the attachment from the adjacent cell. They are called as acantholytic cell. They become round. Initially they are polygonal, but when they lose the connection, they become round in shape. And these round shaped cell with hyperchromic nucleus, with a perinuclear halo, large size, all of this tells that we are dealing with a case of pemphigus or intraepidermal acantholytic disorder. Now please look at this point. The desmosomes are damaged in pemphigus. True. Pemphigus has autoimmunity against desmosome again. What part? It is the desmoglein they are talking about. And what form of autoantibody? It is the I. So the correct answer becomes option number 1. Okay, fine. I hope this is clear to all of you. Please give me a quick thumbs up. Now comes to another question. Anyone? Anyone can tell me the answer of this question? Pick the part of desmosome. Fine. Now please look at this image. This is an image taken directly from the Root textbook. Now this is a cell. And this is another cell. And what are these structures? They all are component of desmosome. Now you can see there are few components which are extending into the intercellular space. The blue color one is desmoglein and the yellow color one is desmocholine. So please look at this part. So there are two components. Both these are in between or outside the cells, so known as intercellular component. While there are many structure present inside, can you see this purple color, this green color, this orange color? All these are plaquin group of family, plakophilin, plakoglobin, desmoplakin. This plaquin group of family constitute the intracellular component. And these intracellular components connect the desmosomes or the intercellular component to the keratin intermediate filament. So these are the different structures of desmosome. Now please look at this feature. Pick the part of desmosome. Desmoglein, yes. Intercellular. Desmocholine, yes. Intercellular. Plakophilin, intracellular. Laminin, no. Please remember, basement membrane is made up of two part. The upper part is lamina lucida and the lower part is lamina densa. Lamina lucida is further made up of laminin, alpha 6 beta 4 integrin and BP antigen 2 or BP 180. These are the component of lamina lucida, while lamina densa is made up of collagen 4. So that is why the correct answer here becomes option number 1. Amazing. So Vigyan, you are absolutely right for this particular question. Fine, let's move to the next question. Please answer this question given on your screen. Anyone? Vigyan, Achan, Kanchan. very nice. So 50-year-old lady was diagnosed with breast carcinoma. He underwent chemotherapy and presents with hair loss after 3 weeks. What is this pattern of hair loss known as? So 40-year-old lady diagnosed with breast cancer and underwent chemotherapy, present with loss. Now please remember, there are few points I just want all my dear students to remember. Now we have different type of hair. Anagen, catagen, and telogen. Now anagen phase is active growth phase. So the length of the hair determined by the anagen phase. And in the anagen phase, you have rapidly dividing cells, very, very rapidly proliferating cells, because they are all the growing cells. So they produce new cells. In catagen phase, which is around 2 to 4 weeks or even 3 weeks, you have a catabolic stage. This is a catabolic stage. Now just look at the lower part of the hair, what is happening. In anagen phase, the hair is completely normal, going up to the stratum or subcutaneous tissue. The lower part shows a dermal papilla, which supplies the blood vessel. Now what happens in the anagen phase? The hair starts to move upwards. It starts to detach from the papilla. So there is cessation of proliferation at the dermal papilla. Now when you move to telogen phase, which is a resting phase, there is complete detachment. Can you see? The hair becomes completely detached from the hair papilla. And this type of hair gives a characteristic club shape appearance. It has reached more towards the upper side. And this is called as the club shaped hair. Now, after telogen phase, there is shedding of the hair. And you can see that the hair is shedding. You can see the empty hair follicle and the new hair have already started forming at the lower part. So that is how you have the sequence of the hair cycle. Now please remember, the chemotherapeutic agent always affect the rapidly growing cell. And rapidly growing cells are seen in, as correctly said by all of you, Vigyan and Pratha, it is seen in anagen effluvium. So please remember the three phases. The hair starts to detach itself from the hair papilla in the catagen phase. Anagen phase, there is a complete telogen phase, there is a complete detachment, and after that the hair will shed and the new hair will start to grow from below. Please answer the next question. Please answer this question, all of you. The first line treatment for acne comedone is topical steroids, topical antibiotic, benzoyl peroxide, or topical retinoid. So, what is the correct answer here? Anybody can tell me? Very nice. Now please look at this image. You can see there are multiple papules with a black dot. This is called as open comedones. Now, what happens? What is comedones actually? For that, you need to understand the basic pathogenesis of acne vulgaris. First thing, what is acne vulgaris? It is the deformity of pilosebaceous unit. Now, please look at this part. This is the hair. You have attachment of sebaceous gland, and this duct opens into the hair follicular unit. Now, can you see this white material? It is coming out of the sebaceous gland, entering the duct, and it is going to distribute itself at the top on the surface. So this is how it is distributing. Now, what happens in acne vulgaris? This sebaceous material, which has to be come out, what happens because of proliferation of the skin at the follicular opening, or because of sealing of the skin, keratinization of the follicular opening, the sebaceous material will not come out. It will remain inside the skin. So both these conditions, the white one and the black one, is the stage one, when there is hyperkeratinization of the follicular opening. Now, sometimes what happens, there is a little bit of space through which the air enters inside the follicular opening, and this air will cause oxidation of the sebaceous material, making it black in color. This is called as a blackhead. While if there is no entry of oxygen, the sebaceous material remains white, and this is called as a white head. Now, what happens, the propionate bacteria, which is the normal commensal, it starts to accumulate, and when it starts to proliferate, it attract the white blood cells towards it, and when the white blood cells comes in a large number, they will give rise to lesions like pustules. They can even rupture. Can you see it started rupturing into the surrounding tissue and can give rise to formation of nodules and cyst. So that is how the lesion of acne progresses. From comedone, that is white head, black head, it goes to papular stage, pustular stage, and the rupture leads to the nodulocystic type of acne. Now, what was the question? Question is, how to treat a comedone? So we have discussed that in comedone you have hypercornification or keratinization of follicular opening. We have hypercornification or keratinization of follicular opening, and this hypercornification or keratinization can be removed by topical retinoid. Okay, is this clear to all of you? Please give me a quick thumbs up if this point is clear. Understood? Fine. Because the mechanism of action of topical retinoid is also the same, it causes exfoliation of the skin. That is why we will use that as the treatment of it. Fine, chalo. Let's move to another question. Anyone? Rocky, Sudha, Nazmul, Partha, Vigyan. Anyone can answer this question? The patient was treated with steroids for psoriasis. On stopping the treatment, he developed fever malaise. The lesions are seen in the image below. What is the probable diagnosis? Now, the correct answer is option number 4, acute generalized pustular psoriasis. Now, always remember that you never give steroids in a patient of psoriasis. How does psoriasis present? So, psoriasis usually have a very well defined lesion which is red in color. You can see it here, I can zoom this for you. Psoriasis have a very well defined nature with erythematous lesions which is associated with silvery white scales. Can you see this white scales? So this is known as silvery white scales of psoriasis. Now sometimes what happens, these psoriatic patients are ill treated by the non-professional doctors or quacks and they are given steroids. What happens when you give steroids in a patient of psoriasis? This well-defined nature of the lesion is lost. You will not find any well-defined papules or plaque in the patients. Then what happens? They will lose to form, or they will lose the well-defined nature, they will become ill-defined and involves more than 90% of the body surface area. This is called as erythrodermic psoriasis. When the well-defined nature of the lesion is lost and the lesions involve more than 90% of the body surface area. Another thing which happens is formation of pustules. Even pustular lesions can be seen in the patients when the steroid is withdrawn, and sometimes these pustules involve all over the body to form large lake of pus and peeling of skin. And this when it is associated with constitutional symptom known as von Jumbusch disease. So what was given in the question? Please concentrate on the question. The question was, the image is shown which includes a lot of pus containing areas which is discrete to confluent. And he is mentioning that patient is a known case of psoriasis taken steroids. We have recently discussed that either it will present with erythrodermic or will present with pustular lesions. The image is so pustular and there is no option for erythroderma, so this becomes a classical case of acute generalized pustular psoriasis, and definitely you have presence of fever, malaise and you have associated constitutional symptoms. It means it is a case of von Jumbusch disease. Understood, Priyanka, Parth, Nazmul, Rocky? Very easy and a clear question about psoriasis. Now, there are many more questions I want to discuss with respect to psoriasis. But before that, I just want to tell you one thing. Now, in psoriatic lesions, there is a characteristic hypopigmented halo which surrounds the lesion. And what is this hypopigmented halo? Anyone? This is called as Voronoff's ring. This is called as Voronoff ring. And it occurs because of reduction in prostaglandin E2 levels in the blood surrounding the psoriatic plaque. So remember this point, very very important, that the hypopigmented rim which surrounds the lesions of psoriasis, it is nothing but the Voronoff's ring. Fine, chalo. Let's move to the next question. Please answer this one. Very nice. Priyanka, Parth, Nazmul. Okay, fine. Now please look at the image. You can see some of the vesicles. as well as bullet. Now please remember, we have two type of bullet. One is flaccid, where you have wrinkles over the roof, and another is tense, which is looking a very taut bulla or vesicle. Now always remember, flaccid bulla is a feature of intraepidermal split, while tense bulla is a feature of subepidermal. So you have intraepidermal and subepidermal split. Now, flaccid word was given in the question. So it means you are dealing with intraepidermal, and you can easily rule out bullous pemphigoid and dermatitis subepidermalis because both of them are subepidermal. Now, read the question. It says that oral cavity is involved. What happens in these pemphigus group? You have IgG against the desmoglein. Now we have two type of desmoglein, desmoglein 1 and desmoglein 3. Now I just want all of you to please concentrate over this image. Now desmoglein 1 is present here at the upper layer of the epidermis, just below the stratum corneum, somewhere here. So we can mark it with the help of a pen. So this yellow color one is nothing but the affected area for desmoglein 1. And what about desmoglein 3? In desmoglein 3, it is mainly present over this part. So desmoglein 1 is present at the upper layer and desmoglein 3 is present at the lower layer of the epidermis. Now what happens in the patients of pemphigus foliaceus? You have antibodies only against desmoglein 1. So what happens? You have subcorneal split because it is at the superficial layer here, just below the stratum corneum. So in the patients of pemphigus foliaceus, because of affection of desmoglein 1, you have subcorneal split. What about desmoglein 3? In the pemphigus vulgaris, you have antibodies against both 3 and 1, but the concentration of desmoglein 3 antibodies are more. And that is why you tend to develop sub or supra basal acantholysis or supra basal split. Now another important point is, in your mucosal areas like oral cavity, you do not have desmoglein 1. So if there is no desmoglein 1, obviously in pemphigus foliaceus, you will have no antibodies for the mucosa, and that is why the mucosal area remains spared. So if there is mucosal involvement, it cannot be pemphigus foliaceus, because in oral cavity or in mucosa there is no desmoglein 1. So if there is no desmoglein 1, no antibody to damage, and that is why there is no oral mucosa lesion. And if it is oral mucosa present, it should be the answer, option number 1, pemphigus vulgaris. Please give me a quick thumbs up if this is clear. Please give me a quick thumbs up if this point is clear. Theek hai ji, fine. I hope it is clear to all my dear students. Fine. So, let's discuss another question. Arrange the following blistering disorders from superficial to deep. Anyone can tell me the answer. Fine. For understanding these type of questions, you need to know a little bit about the different layers. Now the subcorneal split or granular cell layer split is seen in pemphigus foliaceus, also seen in staphylococcal scarlet skin syndrome and bullous impetigo. Then spinous cell, that is the middle layer, you have frictional blister, viral blister and eczematous lesions. Just above the basal layer you have pemphigus vulgaris. You also have Haley-Ellie disease and Derrier's disease. At the level of stratum basale, it is the mechanobullous disorder, that is epidermolysis bullosa simplex and toxic epidermal necrolysis. And what are present below this, that is subepidermal bullous pemphigoid, epidermolysis bullosa acquisita, dermatitis herpetiformis, epidermolysis bullosa junctional, then epidermolysis bullosa dystrophica, erythema multiforme, even bullous ellei is here only, subepidermal, even burn patient you will see subepidermal acantholytic disorders. Now let's go to the question that we have discussed. Arrange the following from top to bottom. We have discussed that pemphigus foliaceus was subcorneal. Vulgaris was suprabasal. Bullous pemphigoid was at the level of basement membrane and EB dystrophica was at the level of dermis. So the answer becomes number 3, number 1, number 2 and number 4. That is option number 4. Clear? Swarna, Parth, Parli, Nazmul, Meghana, Divakar, Parli. Clear? Fine. Next question is on your screen. Anyone? Which of the following is the true association? Now the correct answer is psoriasis. Please remember, psoriasis is associated with obesity, that is high waist to hip ratio. Then hypertension, hyperlipidemia, what is the another one? So obesity is hypertension, hyperlipidemia. Anybody can tell me the next point? Yes, even diabetes. And ultimately all these together are known as metabolic syndrome and they can give rise to cardiovascular accidents. So always monitor a patient of psoriasis with respect to the cardiovascular abnormalities because there is a higher chance that the psoriatic patient can move towards that end. Fine. Please answer this question. Very nice. So, this is a very important question and a very frequently asked question, that a patient with dental amalgam history presents with white lacy pattern. It becomes a classical case of oral lichen planus. Now just look at this question. Now these type of oral lacy lines, which gives you a complaint of burning sensation, patient will complain that, ma'am, I'm having burning, and he will not able to appreciate this. But when you examine, you can see the white lacy pattern or reticulate type of lichen planus in the oral mucosa. And when you examine the surrounding teeth, you will see presence of dental amalgam, which is one of the very precipitating or a very important feature for development of lichen planus on the oral cavity. So please remember, everyone, this is very, very important. How does the oral lesions look like? And we have around 30 to 70% of the patient of lichen planus having the oral lesions. So oral lesions are seen in a lot of patients. How does the cutaneous lesions look like? So we use 5 P's to describe the lesions of lichen planus. That is plain, polygonal, purple, pruritic and papule. These are the 5 P's of lichen planus. 5 P's of lichen planus. And you can see it here as well. There is presence of Wickham's tri. So this is a lesion. When you zoom this, it looks somewhat like this. You also see the lacy pattern on the top or over the top of these papules. These lacy pattern, which is present over the top of this papule, this is called as Wickham's tri. This is called as the Wickham's tri. Very, very important for your exam. Okay, ji, fine, done. So this is how the patients of lichen planus or the lesions of lichen planus looks like. Now, let's move to the next question. A 30-year-old female with lacy lesions in the oral cavity and genitals. Her proximal nail fold have extended onto the nail bed. What is the most likely diagnosis for this patient? Nazmul, Parth, Parli, Divakar. Anyone? 30-year-old female with lacy lesions in the oral cavity and genitals. Her proximal nail fold have extended onto the nail bed. What is the most likely diagnosis? Very well done. The answer is lichen planus. Now what is this? This is a pterygium. Can you see that the proximal nail fold is extending onto the nail plate and going and fusing with the nail plate? This is called as dorsal pterygium. And it is one of the very, very specific feature of nail lichen planus. So, no confusion, a classical case of lichen planus, dorsal pterygium. Coming to the next question. Treatment of multibacillary leprosy. Two drugs in 12 months, 2 drugs in 6 months, 3 drugs in 12 months, or 3 drugs in 6 months. I think it is something which everybody will solve very quickly. Swarna, Nazbul, Parth, Parli, Divakar. I think there should be no confusions with respect to this particular question. Very well done, amazing. So the treatment of multibacillary leprosy is 3 drugs in 12 months. So nowadays we use uniform MDT. According to National Leprosy Eradication Program or according to WHO new guidelines, we give for both MB and PB, we give 3 drugs and we give the MB kit, that is red in color. The only difference is you have to give this kit for 12 months in MB and 6 months for PB. Please remember, this is very, very important, the treatment of multibacillary leprosy. Fine, I hope this is clear to all of you. Please give me a quick thumbs up. Fine. So that is what I was telling you. Now another question is, how to know that it is possibacillary? So for making it possibacillary, remember, there should be 1 to 5 skin lesions, one or no nerve, and slit skin smear should be negative. And for multibacillary type, you should have more than 5 skin lesions, smear positive, and more than equals to 2 nerves. So I will take the lower limb, maybe for the next month, not for this month old. So I hope you have attended the upper limb and the head and neck part, the rapid revision course. Fine, chalo. So I think these two questions are easy. And now please look at this. You give for both of them, multibacillary or possibacillary, you give 3 drugs in which rifampicin, clofazamine is given supervised once in a month, Dapsone given daily unsupervised, and clofazamine 50 mg is given daily unsupervised. So that is the protocol. And that is the blisters. This is how the blister look like. This is how the blister look like. Fine, clear? Please answer this question. So please remember, when a female comes with the grey foul smelling discharge and on examination you see epithelial cells present on the margin, this becomes a classical case of bacterial vaginosis. And what are these? These are glue cells. Bacterial vaginosis, and they are nothing but the glue cell. So with this we are done with the today's session. We will be conducting these crash course on dermatology 1 hour per session, two times in a day. And today we have another session at 8 p.m. So I request all of you to please be live. I want you to give me a thumbs up if you like this class. Subscribe to Unacademy using the referral code CHESHTA10. And please become the part of this YouTube channel, that is Let's Crack NEET PG. Don't forget to press the bell icon for the further notification of the classes. Thank you and take care, all my dear students.